Oftentimes we'll say, well, we had a great day yesterday. Sometimes it's just a word of saying everything went all right. Other times we mean that it was exceptional. We have days like that, but this day was exceptional to the other days like it. And then sometimes people are surprised and they just as a byword say, well, great day. So great day gets used in all sorts of ways. But there is a great day coming. And you recognize that as being in a song. There's a great day coming. So in reality, though we do not think of it very much, there is an hour of hours to which all of our lives are leading. All history flows to the final appointment through which the destiny of each person who has ever lived will be sealed forever. I dare say we don't give a lot of thought to that. We may think more about the day we die. And that's serious enough because all opportunity to change whatever needs to be changed to please God is gone at death. But I'm thinking about what Paul said in Acts 17:31. Because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. I don't know that in our secular age that we emphasize that as much in the preaching of the gospel as we ought to. Now, Paul is standing on Mars Hill in the midst of a bunch of philosophers and so forth. They don't know the God that is the real God. And yet in preaching to them, he made it clear there is a great day coming. All of us will be judged by Jesus Christ on the basis of how we lived each day of our life, no matter how short or long those days were. We need to be reminded that God is keeping the book of your life where each thought and each deed is recorded. And soon, perhaps much sooner than any of us think, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. 2 Corinthians 5:10. If you go over to the last book of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 20, you'll find this recorded beginning in verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell, better Hades, delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There's another song that we sung having to do with the book of life, and it asks a question: is your name written there? Well, we all, if we're honest, want our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because if it's not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, then you will not receive glory in heaven. There are some plain facts about this great day. In other words, the Bible is very clear in preparing each one of us for the final day. First of all, it is a very certain thing. You remember in Acts 17:31 that in effect Paul's saying, as surely as Jesus Christ of Nazareth was raised from the dead, there's going to be a judgment day. And we find that as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. There's no escaping it. It's coming just as surely as this day came, and we came here to do what faithful Christians do in the worship assemblies of the saints on the first day of the week. So it is certain. It's not a partial day in looking at the facts about it. It's universal. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. Matthew 25 and verse 32. Paul said to the church at Rome in Romans 14:10, for we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Well, that's meant to be a soul-jarring thing to those unprepared to meet their God. But it should offer no fear to anyone who is prepared. I know also that on that day, this is an individual thing. We do so much in groups today. And so you have, even in the last many years, people being called groupies. But not on that day. Each person accountable for his actions will stand by himself or herself before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of all that we did in this life. If you read what Paul said to the church at Corinth, and remember this was said to the churches, not to those outside of Christ, not that it doesn't apply, but there had to be a reason it was written to the churches. And it's to encourage them to remain faithful is exactly what it is. Paul wrote, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. 1 Corinthians 3:13. There won't be any excuses on anybody's part. And if you notice, when Christ gives a preview of the judgment, people try to make excuses, but I wish you would notice there, Matthew 25, that he just ignores their excuses and goes ahead and pronounces sentence upon them. So the day of judgment, this great day, is not a time for pleading our case. That's being done right now in the flesh. The jury is out, if you please, right now. So we must understand that when it comes to the judgment, it is a time of giving account of how we lived on earth and of being sentenced accordingly. That's what it means to be judged. It's not to be determined whether you're saved or lost. That's sealed when you die here. So it's a great day in many ways, and some might even not describe it as great, but horrible in the sense they go before that judgment seat unprepared. We've already seen that the books will be opened. The scriptures teach us that the judgment will be full and it will be complete. The scripture reads in Ecclesiastes 12:14, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. The writer of Hebrews, in Hebrews 4 and verse 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. But all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Then I read too, am I a God at hand, saith the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can any hide himself in secret places that I shall not see him, saith the Lord? Do not I fill heaven and earth, saith the Lord, Jeremiah 23:23-24. And again to the church at Corinth, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, 1 Corinthians 4:5. You get the idea that nothing's going to be hidden, nothing kept back when it comes to each one of our lives as we give account to Christ for our actions. The judgment will be under the direction of an impartial God, but I like the next part, with a merciful Savior presiding. Remember at the conversion of Cornelius and his household that Peter saw something. He understood something he had not understood before this happening. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Hebrews 10:34-35. We are constantly throughout our lives via various news media seeing people that are great as far as the way this world measures great, in wealth and in power and talent of various descriptions, to great extent one way or the other. But you know, they'll be in the line with the poorest of the poor, and everybody all in between, for God is no respecter of persons. The judgment is going to be conducted by a flawless standard. Paul wrote in Romans 2:16, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. And it's going to read and mean in that day just as it reads and means today, and has read and mean as long as it's been on this earth. When people say, I don't have to be baptized to be saved, the Scripture still says that baptism doth also now save us, 1 Peter 3:21. When people teach that all you have to do is mentally assent or believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that's all I need to do, Mark will still be recording Jesus' words, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And so you can use that as an example of everything else God has obligated man to do to demonstrate his faith, his confidence and trust and love of God. It's just that way. Now, why men will argue against the plain words of the Bible, I don't know. Oh, and by the way, since we've mentioned this quite a bit lately, it won't hurt to remember that this also will read then as it does now, and it will mean then as it does now. Paul wrote to Christians regarding worship and one item of that worship on the first day of the week. Now concerning the collection of the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. It'll mean then what it means now. It won't change at all. And each one of us are subject to it. The same regarding the assembling together with the saints. People can come up with all sorts of reasons not to assemble with regularity and steadfastness with the saints. But the writer of Hebrews makes it very clear that we are expected. In Hebrews 10:25. To not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some was in that day, has been, and will be. The faithful assemble as the Lord directs them to assemble, and in that assembly, they do as God directed them to do in it. And thus, is what Jesus said in John 12:48 won't change. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The words that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. We have every bit of it right here. This won't change. There's the standard of judgment. It's before us every day, all day long. We know what it's going to be. So don't you think we're pretty much without excuse if we're unprepared? So when you read about anything that has to do with living the Christian life, then it's going to mean then what it means now. When we're taught in the worship to sing, in every passage of Scripture in the last will and testament of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has sing in it, then why do I want to do anything else in music but sing? That's safe ground, folks. That's what the King ordained. It's not because I like it or you like it or don't like it. It's because that's what he said. And faith is taking Christ at his word. It will be a day of surprises. Every time I see somebody I know that was dedicated to a religion that I know is not set out by the Lord in the New Testament, how do I know? I can read it for myself. And I can evaluate it in the light of the truth that God expects us all to know, John 8:31-32. And I think what it must be like, and I can't fathom it, to think that he's entering eternity fully acceptable to God, to find out it's right the opposite. Horror of horrors. And yet that happens regularly, no telling how many times a day. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord. Well, we know they got that far. They know who he is. And they knew who he was in his life. Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied by name? The thought they had they? And they're saying this to him on the day of judgment. And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. Now notice what I said earlier. The Lord never says, well, let's discuss this. The time of discussion and reasoning is over and done with. This is the day of sentencing on the basis of how you lived your life here. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me. Now, were they really faithful? No. Listen to what he says. Ye that work iniquity. Whatever they thought they were doing that were well-pleasing to their God, what did Jesus call it? Iniquitous works. Sinful works. Erroneous actions on their part. Well, how could that be so? Well, we're back to Colossians 3:17. Whatsoever ye do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. They said they did that, you notice. And this is the Lord telling us about what he knows is going to happen. But he said those works were not in my name. They worked iniquity. How does that happen? Well, you have your mind made up to do something a certain way, and mom and daddy did it that way, and all the family did it that way, and all the good friends you have all your life that seem so fine and upright are doing it that way. It must be right, and they're awful pious people. Well, doesn't that sound like the people that are pleading their case are trying to Jesus? Indeed it does. Well, what does the Lord say about it? I profess unto them, I never, never, I never knew you. Depart from me. What is it that we were doing? Christ calls it iniquity. Some's going to be surprised that God accepts no excuses. Many of us in the church think because we've been baptized into Christ for the remission of alien sins and the Lord has added us to the church, and that's a great thing. Don't want to underestimate what a wonderful thing that is. We always rejoice when we hear people obey the gospel and become Christians. But that's the beginning of the journey. Now there are going to be things to try one's faith in Christ the rest of their days. And they'll have to grow to greater knowledge of the New Testament and how to face life's problems with the Thus Saith the Lord. And experience a great many things and always strive to answer the problems or solve the problems with what the Bible teaches. But many people just make up their mind that they'll just excuse themselves. How many times have you been in a group and you had to move through the group and you said, "Excuse me, please," or "Pardon me"? Some people try that with Christ. "Well, yes, I can read. My mind says I know what that says David Brown ought to do or ought not do, or the way he ought to do it. But excuse me, please." It won't work. God will not accept churches founded upon the commandments and doctrines of men. I don't doubt their sincerity. I just don't doubt that at all. But you see, you can be sincerely wrong. And the only way to know whether you're sincerely right or sincerely wrong is an honest investigation of the truth. God didn't put his book down here to divide men. It was to unite men. 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 10. Be of the same mind and the same judgment. That's not the case with the denominationalism. They're not of the same mind and the same judgment. And in the church, we must not get to think that, well, they believe one way, some other church over here believes another way, and oh, that's all right, they're good people. I knew Uncle Fufu back when he was a boy, and he was a real good guy. He paid his bills and all this stuff. That's our level and way of estimating who's good and who's not. The Bible gives you God's way of doing it. Jesus made it clear, every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. Now, did he mean what he said? And did he say what he meant? And if it doesn't have any application, why is it in the Bible? It's obvious then that we must have a "Thus saith the Lord" for everything we believe and practice, Colossians 3:17, or it's not acceptable to God. And I can know what's right, and I can know what's wrong, and I can know whether I'm in harmony with it or I'm not. Whether I have outside of Christ and need to obey the gospel to become a New Testament Christian, or whether in Christ I'm reviewing my life to see whether I'm what I ought to be. God will not judge us by what others are doing, or not doing, as the case may be. Believe it or not, we pull that fast one on ourselves because you do not pull it on God more than we'd like to think. When we're thinking about our actions in the church, if you don't watch out, it just slips in. "Well, I'm doing more than so-and-so. Or I'm as good as so-and-so in what I do and what I give and my life and this, that, and the other. Surely then, if he's such a fine person, I must be too." That's not the way to examine ourselves. Paul wrote to the church at Rome and explained that to them. In Romans 14:10-12. "But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother?" Then notice where he puts this. "For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So that every one of us shall give an account of himself to God." And the whole point in that first part of the verse, don't think about your brother or sister from the standpoint of where you are and what you need to do or not do. You compare and contrast your thinking and speaking and living in the light of the truth, the perfect law of liberty, James 1:25. It may also surprise some people that God's not going to judge us by our good intentions. Felix, remember, trembled at the gospel when it was preached to them, and then said to Paul, "Well, I'll call for you at a more convenient season." That seems to be saying, "My intentions are good, I'll get around to it." God will judge us by our deeds, and what his deed was at that time is, "I'm putting this off because it's eating me alive, and I'll consider it later on." That's what he did. Now, when he comes before God in judgment, that's what he'll get account of. Having heard the truth, he'd save his soul, even to the point of making him tremble physically. "But I'll take care of this later on," Revelation 20 and verse 12 make it very clear that we'll be judged according to our works. Now, it may come as a surprise to some people, but there will actually be three verdicts given on the day of judgment. Three. First of all, Matthew 7, 21 through 23, is said to those who did not obey the gospel of Christ. They did not become Christians. And there Christ says, I never knew you. The next one, Matthew 25, 12, said to those who prepared but who let their lights go out, I know you not. May have known them once, but at the time of the judgment, he does not know them. Now, the one I like and the one I crave to hear is Matthew 25, 21, said to the faithful servants of God who died in the faith, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter ye into the joys of thy Lord. Now, if we're honest with ourselves, we all want to hear that one. But don't let us slip and slide off into one of these other areas to where we're judging ourselves on the basis of what God does not judge us on. Now, a person sitting here today who's honest with God and himself and the Bible can know whether they're in Christ or outside of Christ. If they believed on the basis of the evidence of the Scriptures that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the Son of God, that's all well and good. It must be. One has never become a Christian without doing that. For even the devils believe and tremble, and they're certainly not saved. They're still devils, though they believe and tremble. So it's obvious belief alone won't save anybody. If it would, it'd save the devils, but it didn't, did it? But belief is necessary. It's essential. Jesus said, if you believe not that I am He, ye shall die in your sins. But the same Bible that teaches that belief is essential commands each believer to repent of his or her sins, Acts 17:30. So it's important to understand, why would I believe this part of the Bible that says believe and then reject this other part of the Bible that says the step in the plan of salvation is to repent of my sins, a thing I must do. But so you may have done both of those. One must confess one's belief or faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, Romans 10 and verse 10. All these three are necessary to qualify you to take that last step. And the Bible teaches hearing the gospel and believing it and repenting and confessing one's faith in Christ. But why do we stop there? As I said in the beginning, the Bible teaches one must be baptized to be saved. The Scriptures are too numerous. Then it's even explained to people who were baptized for the remission of sins in Romans 6. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin, separated from the practice of sin, live any longer therein? Don't you know that we who were baptized into him were baptized into his death? That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Now, when is the new life to be walked in, to be lived? Before baptism? No, it's after baptism. Just read Romans 6. It's written to people who obeyed the gospel. And it's explaining to them how it should work to help them live the new creature in Christ. God be thanked that you were, past tense, used to be no longer the servants of sin. But you've obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine. What is that form of doctrine? Look at verses 3 and 4. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You were buried with Christ in baptism. You were planted. You were immersed in the waters of baptism. And you were raised to walk in newness of life because you were baptized for unto in order to a given end, and that's the remission of forgiveness of sins. Well, why will I talk about the Bible teaches, and that's so important that one must believe, when that same Bible teaches, and that's so important that one must be baptized for the remission of sins? And why do I place remission of sins where the Bible doesn't place it? None of that's going to work on the day of judgment. So we're all at a point, regardless chronologically how old or young we are, because we don't know when we're going to leave this world. And it's like Paul said, the night is far spent and the day is at hand. You know, it's interesting. This sermon I'm preaching, I preached fundamentally that sermon more times than I can count. Which means I preached this when I was quite a young man. You know, I said the same thing when I preached this sermon when I was in my 20s that I say now that I'm 70. And I was just as close to death then as I am now. Oh no, you're 70 now. You haven't got... Folks, when I was 20 and preaching this, I didn't know where I was going to be there the next day any more than anybody here knows where they're going to be there the next day. And there's a whole host of folks that never got beyond their 20s or their 30s or their 40s or their 50s. So while it may be good to say, well, I'm ending my days here, 70, there can't be many more days, how could you say it any different if you were 25? So it doesn't bother me to hear, well, you know, you're 70, you may not live to be. So what? I was thinking the same way when I was 18. You can't guarantee anything because you're here now and you're young anymore. You can guarantee anything because you're old and decrepit. We fool ourselves all the time, and I just don't understand it. So my greatest obligation, and so is yours in all of our lives, young or old chronologically, is to get ready to meet our Creator and give an account of the deeds done in the body, whether good or bad. And the amazing truth is that our time of departure may not be far in the misty future. You could meet the Grim Reaper on the way home this afternoon. Some of you saw this from Anna on Facebook, where she mentioned that one of her friends was killed Friday night. These girls were going home from work. I think there were seven of them in the car, and they were hostesses at the same place where Anna works. And Anna, according to Rachel, was saying, you know, I just talked to her this morning. I just visited her today. And now she's dead. And, you know, she wasn't even 70 years old. She was 19. Going back to the summer of 1967, working summer work while I was in college, International Paper Company, there was a young man who graduated in high school who was a year behind me. And he was working out there too. Rather wild character. And while we were working there, I have the same picture in my mind. I saw him one day, and the next day I got to work, found out he'd been killed, driving drunk. He wrapped his car around a tree when he didn't make a curve. Well, we had known the family a long time, so my folks and my grandparents all went up to the funeral home. We had known his grandparents, and he was well known in that area because his parents had owned a grocery store there forever. We had shopped there many times. But Cosby was probably 19, thereabouts. And his grandfather was way up in his 70s, and I never will forget, there when I was probably 20, his grandfather just wailing, why didn't he take me? My life's lived. I'm 70 whatever years old. Why didn't he take me? Why? The reason this happened up here, some drunk in a car crossed clear over from the service road out onto I-45 and T-boned the car and killed the girl immediately, hurting another one quite seriously. How do you answer those? The thing to do is be ready when it comes. And that's what I preached my heart out ever since I was a teenager. I remember one time I was in college and a friend of mine who was he lived in a different dorm. And I was in state school, and he came over one night. I was already going to bed, and he said, David, can you help us? This guy claims to be an atheist. So I went over to next place, and we had some discussion. And it was just a few weeks later that he went to sleep driving and killed himself in a car wreck. He was a few years older than we were, but he was still in his 20s. Isn't it funny we talk about these things? They are reality. They are facts. They're happening right now somewhere. And you can recall those things in your mind. But when we're speaking, there's a great day coming. The saints and the sinners shall be parted right and left. Are you ready for that day to come? But we can be. And the Bible's plain. And we know it. So why do we resist the obvious? What is that says? I know what the Bible says. That's God's word. And I know what it says. But I'm not compliant with the will of heaven. And when it all ends on earth, whether it ends for a young person or whatever. And by the way, middle age, if you're 35, folks, you're middle age. That's half 70. So don't call middle age 50. That's, double that up and you're old. Truth of the matter is we have right now, and that's all we have, whether you're 15, 25, 40, or 80, or 90, wherever you want to go, as long as you're alive in the flesh, that's all you've got right now. So I don't know why we talk about, well, it's getting close to the end. It was close to the end when you were 20. You had no more knowledge of dying then than you do now. Except you thought in your mind, you see, that you were young and that only happened to somebody else who's a lot older. But it doesn't. The great day coming. They'll all stand before the judgment bar of Christ, give an account of the deeds done in the body, whether good or bad. Are you ready for that great day to come? If you're not a child of God, we've studied the great plan of salvation where God will remit every sin that you have when you're baptized to Christ for the remission of sins. Now, child of God, do you have sin in your life you're not taking care of by repenting of it and confessing it and praying to your God to forgive you in God's second law of pardon for the child of God? I can't say more than I said. It would just simply be saying more than really is necessary in this sermon to all those who listen. So if you need to obey the gospel, if you need to renew things in your life, you have now, and you have no more than that. So why not come to the Lord if you need to while we stand and sing?